I think we all expected the performance of New Mexico students to wane during the year plus of remote learning. Policymakers have learned some tough lessons of their own over the past week. Standardized testing was so sparse in 2020 and 2021 that the state isn't bothering to release last year's results, saying it would be an incomplete picture. Legislative analysts think they can piece together an image, but it isn't pretty. They told lawmakers that they believe elementary students have fallen to barely 3 in 10 making grade level progress in math and reading, and they have a sneaking suspicion that estimate doesn't count underachieving vulnerable students. Dan, we've had a sense that students are suffering. Republicans, Democrats are eager to get everything pointed the right way, but are they flying blind here, having no data to work with? Was this the right choice?
Yeah, but they're not flying blind. I mean, the situation has been the same situation in New Mexico for time immemorial. I mean, this is the pandemic.
But this is a little bit. But this is a little bit different, though. This is a little bit different. I mean, those numbers are frightening, honestly.
All it did was exacerbate the problem. This isn't different. All it did was highlight the problems we have in New Mexico. Mm-hmm. You know, people forget that we're a majority rural state. And so when you start closing down schools in some of these small towns, that is the center focal point of all life in that community. Mm-hmm. And that's the place where people go to get services, go to get help, go to get out of bad situations. When you shut that stuff down, there's going to be horrible ramifications rippling through these communities where, you know, they don't have, a lot of these communities don't have, you know, courtrooms and offices, and they got a school. And so, you know, I think that, you know, we're seeing that, we've had sort of a band-aid on a bleeding artery, but once we, you know, shut everything down and put these kids, I mean, even some of the bigger towns, I mean, I remember seeing posts on Facebook in Roswell of kids having to walk over to the school to sit out front of the closed school so they could log onto the internet so they could do their schoolwork.
Oh, yeah.
And so we're shocked that this is, you know, that this is the situation we're having in New Mexico. And, you know, we haven't had good access to internet in this state ever. Now we're talking about spending hundreds of millions of dollars to run wire throughout the state of New Mexico. And everybody's moving from, you know, digital internet to wireless internet. We just always seem to be a day late and a dollar short. Mm-hmm. And I think these numbers have really highlighted it. I hope that this will get people focused on saying we cannot continue to write off entire generations of kids. We have got to address this situation with seriousness. We have to have adults step up to the table, and there's multiple levels of problems. If we don't address this in New Mexico across party lines, we are losing these kids in train loads to our surrounding states.
I'm hearing that. Laura, you know Patty Lundstrom, of course. She heads the Legislative Finance Committee currently. Interesting, she tweaked Hannah Scandera's old line of what gets measured gets done, you might remember that, by saying, quote, you can't understand what you can't measure, end quote. The PED budget is $3 billion in New Mexico. Sort of a similar approach, but what should we look at to get an idea of how to target money? Or is the problem so persistent, as Dan just said, that lawmakers already know at this point?
Well, I mean, I tend to agree with what Dan is saying. This has been a long, long problem we've had. Mm-hmm. But the pandemic has absolutely exacerbated the situation. And I think it's become pretty clear that online learning, distance learning is just rife with problems, especially for students who already may be predisposed to fall behind. The online learning makes it that much more difficult. Mm-hmm. They really need to be in an environment where they have a teacher in front of them, where they're interacting with students, where they're using, you know, multiple skills and not just staring at a computer screen. So I think that we have to figure out how to target that funding to the most vulnerable and get people back into the classrooms. Mm-hmm. The other thing that's exacerbating all of it as well is an increase in retirements.
Yes.
So we're seeing more and more teachers that are retiring sooner than they would have otherwise. Mm-hmm. And that's just creating, it's going to continue to be the case because, you know, teachers who have been in for a long time, they're getting burned out and they're going to continue to retire. So that needs to be addressed. And the legislature could do a lot, I think, to increase, you know, recruitment of new teachers, training teachers, and getting more people into the classrooms.
40% increase in retirements for teachers and school staff. That's the biggest raw number in 7 years. That's amazing, Michael. when you think about it. Hey, real quick, I want to get back to this idea of how we don't have data on this. It was an interesting quote, Michael, from our Secretary Designate for Public Education Department, Kurt Steinhaus. Quote, our research and evaluation department does not exist, end quote. He said in response to recommendations by an LFC analyst Wednesday, meaning they don't even have the staffing necessary to track data and meet the demands of education-related legislation. Something's quite wrong there. This is the worst time possible, it would seem to me, to have that department underfunded and understaffed. What's the ramifications of this?
Well, let me just say something. The Yazzie Martinez case clearly, mm-hmm. I mean, that's the miner's canary for all of this education. And I think you can make a case. That case has already been made that there are populations and communities that have whose needs have never been met.
Yeah.
In addition to what's going on now with the you don't have good data. I mean, that's how long has there been a Department of Education? How long have we had major institutions, mm-hmm. universities here in the state of New Mexico, and nothing has, and this is all we have at this point? When you pivoting off what happened with COVID really has demonstrated the lack of solid infrastructure and investment in schools, in medical care, in roads, in many systems that you need, that a sophisticated community needs to for its people to begin with pre-COVID. Now with the advent of COVID, it's taken out, it's impacted all of those systems, education, healthcare, and a whole host of others. And so until we really, I think, look at a systems approach to building a solid infrastructure that supports these things, that produces educated, healthy people in a community, we're going to continue to have these sort of issues, and we're going to continue to struggle. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is, I wonder how many legislators have their children who are school age. How many of them are in private schools? How many of them are in the public system? I think that's a fair question. Somebody needs to look at that, mm-hmm. because maybe there'd be more investment if they, in fact, had children that were part of those systems and not in private schools. Mm-hmm. Just something to think about.
Interesting point there. Hey, Daniel, there's also the problem of being able to compare various versions of standardized testing, which has changed a lot in the past few years. As you know, our current governor moved away from the PARC tests required by our former governor, but the plan to use SAT tests to evaluate high schoolers hasn't rolled out as promised, at least it will be 2022 and maybe even 2023 before we have reliable data. Same question, is that a failure? Are our kids being failed here? Are parents being failed here? What happened?
It's a failure of epic proportions across the board. We have a $3 billion. I mean, look at the amount of money we spend on education year. And we're saying we don't know what the data is. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can't. My wife can tell me what the data is on what we spend on our grocery bill. So, I mean, I don't know how we're spending billions with a B, mm-hmm. billions in a state where the median income is $40,000+ a year. If people aren't listening and saying, wait a minute, we are spending billions of dollars in a department, and the answer is, we just don't know what the results are for that. If that doesn't just make people say, what in God's name is going on? Mm-hmm. I don't know what will. So, you know, I've always believed this when I spent time in the legislature, there were two things you always did. You knew who to ask for the right data, because they would give you the answer you wanted. And the other thing we always used to say, if you don't like the data, just wait a few minutes, it'll change.
That's right.
And, you know, it doesn't surprise me that the answer from everybody is, we don't have this data, we don't have that data. The last governor blamed the governor before that. This governor blames that governor. The legislature blames the LFC. The LFC blames the schools. And at the end of the day, you know, you and I are still pumping out $3 plus billion with a B, people, mm-hmm. tax dollars, and nobody knows what we're getting for it.
After the last word on that, let us know if you've seen any bright spots in education by going to our New Mexico in Focus Facebook page.